Hello, my name is Claire Shovlin, and over the next 5 minutes or so, I want to provide you with an overview of hereditary haemorrhagic telangiectasia, HHT for short. HHT is an inherited condition of the blood vessels affecting approximately 1 in 6,000 people. Most individuals who have HHT know that either they or somebody in their family has frequent nosebleeds. People may also observe red spots on their lips or fingertips. Sometimes these are very prominent, as in this example. Sometimes they are harder to see. In addition, HHT leads to the development of abnormal blood vessels at other parts of the body, and these are often invisible. The most important are called arteriovenous malformations, AVMs for short. These blood vessels provide a direct communication between an artery and a vein, bypassing the capillary bed. Because the blood in arteries is at high pressure and the veins are expecting to receive blood at low pressure, this leads to disturbances in the vein, and we believe this is why the AVMs develop. Most people with HHT will have nosebleeds due to the abnormal vessels in their nose. Nosebleeds do not always get worse with age, just as many people find they improve with age. Most people will end up having some telangiectasia, these red spots visible on their lips, fingertips, or tongue. These do get worse with age in that they become more prominent and more numerous, though can be dealt with by medical treatments. 1 in 2 people have abnormal vessels, AVMs, in their lungs. These are called pulmonary AVMs and are very important because they are responsible for many preventable complications. 1 in 2 people have liver AVMs. These usually sit there silently and usually do not cause a problem, though they may. 1 in 5 people will have blood spots like on the lips and fingertips, but in the gastrointestinal tract, and these can bleed like the nose. 1 in 10 will have abnormal vessels in the brain, such as arteriovenous malformations, AVMs, as shown here. And then there can also be abnormal vessels in the spine and more rarely at other sites. We will come back to why these vessels are important for people in a moment. We know that HHT runs in families and it has a particular pattern of inheritance where, on average, half of the children of somebody with HHT, they develop HHT, and men and women are affected equally. This tells us that the gene that causes HHT is present on one of the numbered chromosomes that come in pairs, and that on a particular pair, one of the copies of the gene is abnormal, as shown here in red, and the other is normal. The gene that is usually affected is either endoglin on chromosome 9 or ALK1 on chromosome 12, although a small number of people with HHT have abnormal sequences in the SMAD4 gene or occasionally other genes. The genes can have abnormal sequence for many different reasons. Parts of the genes can be missing. That's the sections at the top in blue called deletions. Sometimes extra parts are added. Those are insertions. And there can be changes of individual letters in the genetic code that lead to other patterns that we see. The normal function of the genes that are affected by HHT are to code for proteins that sit in or on endothelial cells, the cells that line blood vessels. I've shown a cartoon at the top. This is something I drew many years ago, just to illustrate the types of vessels that we're thinking about and the endothelial cells in the lining of these blood vessels. And below is an image of endothelial cells grown in the laboratory, where they've been stained for endoglin, which you can see is mainly coated around the outside of the cells in red. The proteins, endoglin, ALK1 and SMAD4, all operate in the same signaling pathway. This is a set of pathways that allow the cell to respond to messages that come from the outside. We call those messages ligands, and the important names to remember are TGF-beta and BMP9. These interact with receptors on the cell surface, and then the signals are transmitted to the cell nucleus to change the way the cell behaves. If somebody has HHT, they will have no protein from one of the HHT genes. So they will either have half normal endoglin, or half normal ALK1, or half normal SMAD4. Most of the time, that is fine, and blood vessels develop and function normally, but on occasions, this is sufficient to lead to the development of the abnormal blood vessels. As to how and why the abnormal blood vessels develop, we are really not very much further forward in terms of understanding than we were some years ago. But we do know that the way that these blood vessels develop is driven by having the abnormal genes in the first place. And the exact mechanisms are a major focus of active research. So people with HHT have a number of these vessels that are abnormal. Different people have different proportions of vessels that are abnormal, different types of vessels that are abnormal, and the patterns are not necessarily the same between different members of the same family. Furthermore, just because a blood vessel is sitting there and it is abnormal, it doesn't mean it will necessarily cause a problem. The problems that we tend to see most commonly are the nosebleeds from the abnormal vessels in the nose. But also, compared to the general population, people with HHT are more frequently anemic because they have bled out iron, which they have not been able to replace in their diet. They are more likely to have strokes, which can be due to clotting, the ischemic strokes. Those are due to the pulmonary AVMs, or hemorrhagic strokes, which are much less common, and these are due to cerebral AVMs. People with HHT are more likely to have deep-seated abscesses, including brain abscesses. Again, this is part of the problem from a pulmonary AVM. And we also see more migraines, venous thromboemboli, blood clots, and pulmonary hypertension in people with HHT compared to the general population. There is also an increased risk of maternal death in pregnancy, a risk we can reduce if we manage the pregnancies properly. What is fascinating and has only just become apparent is that people with HHT are in some ways healthier than normal. We see less cancer. That has now been shown by two separate studies, and people with cancer are being given HHT by injection to treat cancer, and it is working. We also seem to see fewer heart attacks, myocardial infarctions, for people with HHT. So it really is a case of being dealt a different hand of cards. Some things need to be thought about more, and some things actually need to be thought about less. And overall, if HHT is managed properly, as has been shown in Denmark, then life expectancy is normal. This concludes the overview of HHT. Thank you for listening.